At the start of this year, the government announced plans to give the arts a more prominent place in the education of second-level students across Ireland. As part of that initiative, schools across the country are encouraged to offer more integration of Ireland's cultural world into everyday school life. Jim Larkin Community College in Dublin City Centre is one of the schools embracing this approach, and earlier this year, their students spent some time learning from Ireland's very first artist in residence at a hotel, Mr. John Morris. Now, John is with me, along with Aoife Kelly Gibson, the principal of Jim Larkin Community College, and Stephen Baldescu, who's a fifth-year student at the college, and Margaret Rafferty, who's a third-year student at the very same school. You're all very welcome to the programme. Now, first of all, to start with the students, Morgan, were you an artistic person?
I thought I was, but not comparing to John, so...
So, do you paint, do you draw, or did you before you met John?
Well, he's a really inspiring teacher, do you know what I mean? He gives you the passion to draw.
Where did you come across him for the first time? Did you go to the hotel? Did you see
him
in action?
Yeah, we went to the hotel and it was great. It was small, but it was great. And I just loved the way it wasn't structured, the way he was learning us. Like, he didn't even realise it. It was, like, great tips.
So he was teaching you without even realising he was teaching you. Yeah. What about you, Stephen? Were you artistic?
Yes, I've been drawing since I was 7 years old. So I focus on doing sketches and portraits, and that's what I do.
All right, so you also came across John at the hotel?
Yes, I spoke on behalf of the students of the school there at the launch.
Oh, you had to make the speech?
Yes.
I'm sure you'd prefer to draw and paint than speak, but there you are. That's a tough thing to have to do, but I'm told that you did it very well.
Thank you.
Now, John, let's talk to you. You're a self-taught artist, is that so?
Yeah, I mean, most artists these days are self-taught because they don't... They don't teach drawing and painting in university now, in the College of Art.
What do they teach nowadays?
I don't really know. It's mostly sort of, conceptual art, abstract.
I mean, one of the things that you should be able to do before you go off in your own particular direction is actually draw properly, isn't that so?
Yeah, of course. I mean, they're the foundations of being a painter. I mean, in the old days... They wouldn't allow, you know, when there was an apprenticeship for painters, if you were starting off, they wouldn't let you go near paint for maybe 2 years. It'd be just charcoal, just drawing with charcoal.
And drawing life and so on.
Exactly, yeah. And copying the master, you know, until you got so good with charcoal that you could move on to paint.
I mean, if you look at Picasso, before we got to cubism, and which is quite geometric, and you'd imagine you could copy it and have a good stab yourself. But if you go back to his Blue Period, for example, you're looking.
But he was a brilliant draftsman. I mean, Picasso
was
a great draftsman before he went into that area of cubism and all that sort of thing. He was a very good traditional painter, you know. And he probably came upon it by accident. I'd imagine, you know.
John, how old were you when you started to paint?
Well, I was very lucky. I went to a very good school, a bit like Larkin. It was very similar to Larkin in the way we had very good art teachers, and so did they.
But did you know you had a talent for it? I mean, when you were a child,
there
are some kids when they're colouring in, and they will colour in precisely marking the borders of the thing in the colouring book, and then their other kids will just take a crayon and...
Yeah, I was one of those kids, but I never really thought about it till I had my own kids.
Yeah.
And they weren't that pushed, you know. They didn't do that much drawing. And I remember when I was a kid, I was always drawing, you know, always, you know, doing something with pencil or with watercolours or something.
And when did you formalise that in the sense that saying, this is what I want to do?
Well, when I was doing the Leaving Cert, we had a very good art teacher. Vinnie Salmon was his name. I mean, I think you might have known him in RTE.
Vincent Salmon, yeah.
Yeah. Do you remember Vinnie?
I do.
He was a brilliant art teacher. Arnie O'Connor was there as well, another art teacher from RTE. And they were very good artists. They were professional artists who worked part-time as art teachers, I think. So they were very encouraging. Vinnie was very encouraging. He used to say to me, look, you've got to go to art college, you know.
Now, what is your style?
Impressionistic.
Okay, so you really have a lot of great masters to look to.
Well, everyone says Monet, you know. Monet was the real big influence for Impressionist painters, but... And that would be the case for me as well, you know. He definitely was the master. And one of the other places actually where there's an artist in residence is in the Savoy Hotel in London.
Uh-huh.
And if you're lucky enough to get that one, they allow you to stay in Monet's room, the window where he painted all those famous paintings from, like was the Houses of Parliament and Waterloo Bridge.
So Monet was an artist in residence in the...
No. But the room that he used, because he was quite wealthy at the beginning of the 20th century, he in not early 1904, 1907, he wasn't like a millionaire. So he could go to the Savoy and he could
so,
take
so
the room.
He was in residence, but he was paying his
bills. Exactly, yeah. So those famous paintings that everyone knows of the Houses of Parliament and Waterloo Bridge, they were painted from that window.
I mean, some people believe that Impressionism came about because of the birth of photography, that you could, in the past, when you had a painting, it was to represent absolutely down to the minute detail. Say, if you were taking if you wanted a picture of a building, it had to be exact.
But I don't know if that was the case. I mean, it might have been, but I think the advent of tube paint, where you could, before there was little tubes of paint.
Yeah.
You had your apprentice in your studio and he would mix and grind the pigments for you and make the paint for you. Once they became available in little tubes, you could put them in a bag and you could go out and sit in the field.
Okay.
So when you're sitting outside in the field, like the painting that I did for the lads here, I went down onto the Millennium Bridge and I painted a painting on the Millennium Bridge. And then I brought it into the school and I put it up on the easel and I did a copy of it.
Okay, right? So you
I did
had
a different
original
version,
and then you
and some photographs, right? And I used the photographs, and so, but that the fact you have tube paints allows you to do that. Before tube paints, you couldn't do that. And how Impressionist painting happened, I think, was that when you're painting outside, you have to paint fast because it changes, right? You know, the clouds. The
course,
shadows
yeah.
change.
It's not like having a sitter who sits still
exactly.
for
you can't
maybe
control
days
it.
On end.
You can't control it. It can start raining, the sun can come out, the sun can go away. It changes. So I think that's really where it came from. You know, you're sitting there.
So, guys, Stephen, what did you make of the Millennium Bridge picture?
I think it was great. I think I learned two important things from working with John. One was that how to experiment with colours, and two is that you need a lot of patience, especially when you're an artist, because you would want to see your work as soon as possible. But as an artist, you need a lot of patience if you want to do great work.
How do you know when your painting is finished? That's a big question for every artist, you know.
Yeah, it is, and it's a difficult one to know.
You keep tinkering.
Yeah, you can push it too far, you know, and you can ruin it. So I think experience really is.
Morgan, what did you learn from the painting?
I thought it was fascinating the way you did one, but then you do it again to perfect it. Like you did more than one, and if you didn't like it, you'd like leave it and go back to one day because you need loads of patience, and probably your mind's not on it.
Yeah.
And John, do you sometimes just wash over it with white and start again?
I scrape it back sometimes, you know, with a palette knife, you can scrape them back.
And people
quickly.
Say, oh no, John, don't do that, though. That's beautiful, that's wonderful, but you're not happy.
No, well, you know when it's not right, so you just scrape it back. It's much easier to do that and start again rather than to try and fix it. You know, the fixing it can be more difficult because you're layering paint on top of paint. Mm. I mean, you just scrape it back, you've got a nice clean canvas to start again.
Yeah. By the way, how did you become an artist in residence at the Gibson Hotel? First time they did it.
Oliver Gormley's my gallery in Dublin, and he was approached by the Gibson Hotel. They had this idea of trying to start this residency, and they asked him, did I know anyone who might be interested in doing it? So. My house was being renovated in Mount Marion at the time.
Very
I thought, this is perfect.
So how long were you in residence?
2.5 months.
And what did you do? I mean, did you have to share your talent with the guests or did they simply observe you in action?
We had a camera in the studio and they could watch on their TVs, and then people would come up and sit with me. But I have that anyway. I mean, people come to the studio and sit with me because it's quite a lonely old business, painting all day on your own.
But you can't be, if you're on the webcam or on the CCTV, you can't be picking your nose or doing anything like that.
I did anyway.
You will be watched.
I did. Give them something to talk
about. Now, Aoife Kelly Gibson is principal at Larkin Community College. How did you get involved in all of this?
Well, the first thing I have to say is that I'm brand new to this job since September.
Oh, congratulations.
So I've come into this and been completely overwhelmed by the exciting adventures that go on in Larkin Community College. So,
For people who haven't ever had children at a community college versus secondary school, what's the difference?
Well, I suppose every school has its own kind of way of living and, you know, its own little community going on. But I suppose the difference in Larkin as opposed to other schools that I've worked in is There's an unbelievable enthusiasm among the staff and the students for experimenting, trying out new things, you know, just getting involved in different things and saying, well, sure, we'll give it a go and we'll see how we get on, you know. And it's very fresh, it's very new. There's a huge amount of learning goes on that is not only based in classroom, and the teachers themselves are hugely creative and skilled and very happy to try new things. So, you know, it all benefits. There's a huge amount of benefit going on in the whole
Now, he college. Was arts in residence, John was, at the Gibson Hotel. Mm-hmm. Part of your name is Gibson. Are you related to the hotel?
No. And you know, it's funny, when we went to the launch, actually some of the students asked me if I owned the hotel. Wouldn't I love that? But no.
So how did that come about, that synergy between John as artist in residence and the school?
Well, we have a long history in the school of creative engagement, and there's a woman called Maura O'Higgins who works with partnerships, and Maura has been a powerhouse for creating different types of links with community and industry to do with anything creative. And so we've had the National College of Art, we've had National Museum of Ireland, we've been involved with Localize, the community project organisation, and you know, we've been very fortunate in all of that. And I know that Maura would be on the steering committee with the Arts and Education Charter, and she has a huge number of connections. So yes, she is our person that people contact.
There'll be people saying, look, this gets in the way of the curriculum, that, you know, you've got your exams. Admittedly, Stephen, you're in fifth year, so you have a little bit of spare time. You're in third year, though, Morgan. You know, the exams looming, you probably have mocks coming up, have you?
Oh, don't start me on them.
So, you know, there'll be people saying maybe we shouldn't be diverting the students into other kinds of activities. Such are the demands, particularly of the junior cert curriculum, which is enormous.
I know it is. It is enormous. But for instance, Morgan participates in what's called the Arts Scholarship in the school. So a certain...
So is she being over-modest about her talents?
I don't know. We had a little chat about it earlier, and she seems to be very talented from my perspective. But you know, we offer an arts scholarship and a football scholarship in the school, and so we have all of our subjects running, and alongside that we have different activities to do with drama and dance and theatre, and Morgan has participated in those. And Morgan, you were very interesting about that earlier, because the way you learn is
Explain
because I'm dyslexic, so I'm not good with studying or written exams or anything like that. I'm more with creative stuff, and I just love the Art Scholarship at Lang Community College. I'd recommend it to anyone. It's there's dance, there's art in it, and they zone in on what you're good at, and they make it great. They make it, I just think it's amazing. It's really good for someone
like classic studies don't interest you as much because of dyslexia.
And you need a bit of a break every now and again. And I think it is great. Like, you don't know what, like, you go into the class expecting whatever, do you know what I mean?
Yeah. And Stephen, what about you? What subjects are you doing besides art?
I'm doing history, music and art and Italian, the rest of the permanent subjects. I think it depends on the student. I'm really interested in history and art, so it doesn't really depend on the creativity. So.
Yeah. What do you think of her work, Morgan's work?
I haven't seen any
of his
work.
Have you seen his work?
No, I haven't. I've seen one of his sketches. It is brilliant.
All right. And I was wondering, what did you expect before you met John and you were going to meet this great artist? What kind of preconception did you have in your head? What were you going to meet?
I thought he was going to be very strict. And because he's an artist, you'd think he'd be in a room all his own. And because it's so quiet, he'd be a bit annoyed that we're asking him questions. But it wasn't like that at all.
And what did you expect, Stephen?
Well, I also expected him to be quite serious, but then as time went on, I realised that he was very interested in learning about us.
And much more casual and relaxed than you had anticipated. And for you, dealing with students who would be asking probably sometimes incredibly intelligent questions, other times the blindingly obvious.
Well, they're brilliant. You see, they're very talented as well. But for me, I didn't know what to expect. Really, I didn't know whether, you know.
Did you have really to be persuaded to do this, or did you leap in willingly?
No, I thought that would be the best bit of it. You know, if it went right, I thought it would be fantastic. You know, but I wasn't sure how they'd react to me. You know. Would they be interested even in, because I said, you know, they don't really in art college now, they don't really focus on life drawing and, you know, drawing from life. I mean, so I didn't know if they'd be interested in it. I mean, one of the things they said to me was they never seen anybody drawing from life. They never saw somebody. You know, it was all from their imagination. You know,
yeah.
So like it's changed an awful lot. I mean, kids these days might not be interested in that, but they are. Yeah. I mean, I was very happy with them.
Can you teach anyone to draw, do you think? Or
I think you can teach drawing because it's more mathematical, you know. It's more proportions and stuff like that and practice. But painting might be a little bit more difficult, you know.
You think life drawing, you can actually tell someone, okay, that the proportions of the shoulders to the hips and, you know, where how long the neck should be.
Exactly.
You can teach
like
that to
eyes,
a degree.
The eyes are halfway down the head and
which,
so on.
Which you asked anyone, they would say, no, they're at the top of the head. But
well, some people think they're toward the way up, you know.
Yeah, yeah. And that's not so.
Yeah.
I'm now looking at you and because... Yeah. I can actually see the top of your skull. Anyone on the webcam will know what I'm referring to. You're right.
Yes.
The chin to the top of the crown, the eyes are halfway.
Yeah. So things like that, I mean, you can teach that and then practice, obviously. But it's like any, it's a craft.
Yeah.
It's like any craft. It's like trying to teach somebody how to make a chair from a book.
Yeah, yeah.
It's much easier to watch a carpenter.
Doing it.
Maybe the book is a nice reference afterwards.
Yeah. But you're, it's the same with everything, even a new mobile phone. If you get someone to show you how to to use it, it's much quicker than reading the help screens or whatever. So a worthy experiment, Aoife, and you'd do it again?
Oh, in a heartbeat. I my only problem is, I was saying that to the students, that I can't be in the room all the time to experience it with them because I have to do other stuff. But I think from the point of view of enriching a learning experience, you know, I mean, there's a huge amount to be gained by, you know, branching out into all of these different artistic endeavours. So, and I think from the point of view of also seeing that there is that somebody like John is successful, that where he's come from, what he's done, how he works, and, you know, that he's a real person doing a real job, that's very tangible for students.
Going back in time, John, to you, I mean, what were you expected to do when you left school by your family? Because I bet it wasn't painting.
I don't know, of course not. I went to Ballyferma Tech, so it's not really a career choice, you know. Probably carpentry or something like that, you know.
Yeah.
I think carpentry is a great trade, so it's a lovely one to do as well. But not really in any of the professions, you know. It wasn't really...
So much to their continued surprise, you're a great
probably.
Success
yeah.
as an artist.
I mean, back then, I remember reading an article back years ago about, I think... 1% of the population in Ballyferma went to university.
Yeah.
And so it wasn't really an option. You know?
Happily, that percentage has gone up dramatically
which is
fantastic. With, so-called free university education, it's not so free anymore.
No.
But still, it is, relatively speaking, I suppose, achievable these days. And there are access programs in Trinity College and so on for students from less privileged backgrounds.
I think the schools are very good now as well. I think. You know, if you see Larkin College, they bring kids from all over the place.
Yeah.
They're not from wealthy families, but they're very motivated kids and they seem to do really, really well.
Do you know what it sounds like? That college, Jim Larkin College, Community College, sounds like an awful lot of fun.
It does.
It is.
For the principal as well as for the students.
Learning should be fun.
I suspect. Before we go, Stephen, I know that you had family in the Philippines, is that right?
Yes.
And the typhoon must have been a scary time for you.
Yes. The city that's been all over the news is called Tacloban City, and that's my home city. That's where most of my relatives lived. It's unfortunate that some of my friends and former classmates died during the typhoon. So my relatives' homes were completely destroyed by the typhoon. For the first 3 to 4 days, we had no idea what had happened to them because all communications to the Philippines were cut off by the devastating typhoon. As far as I know, about 6,000 people have died in our city.
Very difficult because, you know, communications being down for the initial period and worrying and worrying and worrying. Did all of your family members survive?
Yes, they did, yeah.
Which is the good news.
Yes, yeah.
But they still have a lot of time to spend rebuilding their lives and their homes and so on.
Yeah, we're sending a lot of help to them.
Well, that's good. That's good. Stephen, thank you particularly for coming in. And Morgan Rafferty, the from fifth year and third year, respectively. Aoife Kelly Gibson is principal of Larkin Community College and the artist in residence at the Gibson Hotel for a period while his house was being done up. And the man who opened the eyes of students and staff alike at Larkin Community College, John Morris. Thank you all very much for joining us on the programme today.